Good morning and welcome in the name of Christ. We are gathered this morning to celebrate the life of Elaine Degelau, to give thanks and praise to God for her life and witness among us, to grieve, to comfort one another, and to entrust our sister in Christ, Elaine, to God's eternal care and keeping. So welcome to all of you. It is really good to look around this room and see so many family members here, and so many who knew Elaine throughout her 7 decades here at Our Savior's. I see people from the many eras of Our Savior's here today. It's so good to be gathered with you. And welcome to those of you who are joining us on the live stream. You can find a worship folder for the service this morning on our website. You can also please prepare your tables for Holy Communion. We will share in our holy meal where Jesus meets us and nourishes us with life. So please gather bread and wine or crackers and juice or whatever food and drink you have on hand in your kitchen as we share later in the service in Holy Communion together. And for those of you here in the sanctuary, I invite your full participation in worship. That includes singing with full voice. And as we sing hymns together today, you can find a red hymnal either under your seat, if you're in the front row especially, or in the pew rack that's right in front of you and the pew ahead of you. We begin our worship acknowledging that we are indeed in the presence of the living God. Blessed be God, our mother who gave us birth, the source of all mercy, and the giver of all consolation, who comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we have ourselves received from God. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. I invite you to please rise in body or spirit as we sing our opening hymn. The grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Elaine. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Illumine our lives so we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
I'm Pastor Hans Lee, and I'm currently working in the Minneapolis Area Synod office. And Bishop Ann Svenningsen asked me to bring her greeting this morning. And so on her behalf, and on behalf of the Minneapolis Area Synod and the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, where Elaine Degelau served so faithfully for many, many years, I'm here to share just a few words with you this morning. Elaine spent most of her working years serving the church that she loved so dearly, both at the denominational level and in this congregation as well. She worked for the Board of Pensions of the ELCA and its predecessor body, the American Lutheran Church, and its predecessor body, the Evangelical Lutheran Church, beginning in 1959. Elaine continued to serve as an associate in ministry in the ELCA until her retirement at the end of 1992. That's more than 32 years of service to the church. She was one of the founding members of Twin Cities Single Lutheran Adults, where she remained active for 55 years. But what retirement really meant for Elaine was even more time to share her gifts among her beloved Our Savior's community. I've been told that she never missed a Wednesday in the office. She was a fixture of hospitality and service, with authentic warmth and a smile to accompany her many talents. Elaine served as an active member and leader in this congregation for more than 72 years until the age of 94 when the pandemic hit, and yet she remained very connected to you. She treasured the friends she made and the relationships she nurtured throughout her life. Today, I am humbled to bring greetings on behalf of the church Elaine served, and to share the church's deep thanks for her wonderful ministry. We give thanks for Elaine's faithful service to the Lutheran Church in all its depth and breadth, and for the fullness of her life and witness. And on behalf of the church, I offer thanks to her family and to all of you for sharing her with us. We praise God for the servant of the church as we now entrust Elaine to the one upon whom her life was lived, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Thank you.
I would like to begin by sharing a story with you that Elaine wrote. I keep wanting to say the gospel according to Elaine, but it probably is not appropriate, but yet it is. And I quote, "I graduated from Windham High School in 1944, and I have no formal education after high school. My education came from the jobs I had. After graduation, I began working as a bookkeeper at the First National Bank of Windham. After 2 years, I took the job as bookkeeper and only office person at the 21-bed hospital in Windham. I was offered a job in Minneapolis as a bookkeeper for a small manufacturing firm and stayed there for a year. From there, I began working for Lutheran Brotherhood in the Policy Service Department for 9 years. During that time, I worked with many people, departments, and customers. In 1959, I began my services in the pension department of the Evangelical Lutheran Church. I worked for the pension department with new applications and retirements. In those days, many of the members came into the office, there was a lot of personal contact. I knew this was the kind of work I wanted to do. In 1984, when the merger was coming closer and we were not sure of keeping the jobs we had or of getting a new one in the merged church, I realized an office position could qualify one for an associate ministry certificate. I liked working in the congregational setting, so I decided maybe I could be more sure of getting a job in a church if I was certified. So I went for it and became certified. However, I stayed in the ELCA pension department until I retired in 1993, 33 and a half years. I felt it was an unusual experience when I realized I was beginning to retire pastors that I enrolled in the pension plan as newly ordained some students. What a thrill. I have always volunteered for my church. When I at home, I worked with the youth. When I came to Minneapolis, I began attending Our Savior's Lutheran Church in 1951. I continued being active in the various organizations, working with the Sunday school as a teacher, being advisor for the youth group, being an active member in the single adults group, working in the English learning program with immigrants from Laos and Liberia. I still continue to do work in the office one day a week and with the Liberian Fellowship at Our Savior's. What has been most memorable for me during my ministry? I was able to serve God and God's kingdom. I have been able to use and gain new talents. I have enjoyed working with people. I hope I've expressed God's love for me through association with others. Hopefully, I've made the world a better place because I was here." Unquote. The Our Savior's Church community has been richly blessed by Elaine's dedication, participation, her leadership, and her love. For 72 years, she has touched all aspects of the Our Savior's ministries and thereby touched us all. I remember mostly Elaine as a community builder. She reached out to visitors and members with her friendly greetings and smiles, with a warm hello and how are you? Not just a brief greeting, but a deep and genuine how are you that made you feel welcome at Our Savior's community. She radiated those feelings, whether it was at the worship service, meeting with youth, teaching Sunday school, mentoring a refugee, meeting with the Altar Guild, eating with you at a potluck, being available during her weekly church office shift, and many more ways of sharing her love and her faith. Elaine was key in helping to build and sustain a warm and loving community. For sure, we're going to miss her. She loved us, and we loved her. Elaine, you accomplished your goal. If you mentioned from her story, you expressed God's love for you through your association with others. You made the world a better place because you were here. We say thank you, God, for blessing us with Elaine.
I am John Degelau, Elaine's nephew, and I want to thank all of you so much for joining us in celebration of Elaine's life today. In honor of Elaine's time here, I tried to do my best to dress up as a 1950s Lutheran, and we'll see if I'm able to succeed at that. Everyone here, I'm sure everyone that is looking at streaming, everyone could come up and give at least 5 minutes or longer talking about Elaine. So this is a challenge to be able to try to surmise some of the things that we all know about Elaine, but some things that maybe not everybody knew about Elaine. Looking at all of the people here, I can't help but think, but look how good it is. That's one of the songs that We sing in this church sometimes, in Spanish, the Mirin Que Bueno, how pleasant and harmonious it is when all of God's people are together. That seemed to be the driving force behind much of her life in the church. Since she walked through the door here, which she said was 1949, became a member in 1951, our Seavers has never been the same since. Our Savior's got Elaine, but how do we get Elaine? How do we understand her? I think we all do. In her Bible, one of the highlighted passages was Psalm 116. I shall walk in the presence of God. Elaine walked and walked and walked some more. That's how she got to be almost 97. Most of her life, she would walk to work. There was not the need for some silly automobile transportation. We have a good public transportation system, and you could just walk. There were certainly quite a few things with her that I think were more than ahead of her time. I understand her as imagining what I know about some of her life or what she shared about early life and things. And I imagine what that was like. Imagine that you're born a twin. The other half of the twin is over here with my father, Pastor John. A brother who's probably going to get all the breaks. And imagine losing your father in the midst of the Great Depression. You, your brother, and your now single mother really are living in poverty on the edge of homelessness. It's only because of the kindness of the Lutheran church across the street in the neighborhood and the neighbors that you survive and thrive into young adulthood. Imagine the lure of the big city and coming to the big city in Minneapolis in the late 40s and 50s, being what was often called kind of an office girl at the time, ending up working for Lutheran Brotherhood, not Lutheran Sisterhood. Being called to ministry, serving, acquiring most of the skills of a pastor in faith formation, liturgical knowledge with the Altar Guild, but not all of them, because she was a bassoon player in high school and we haven't had too many bassoons in our music here. Knowing that with all these skills, how much you're inspired to minister, but knowing you actually could never be able to come one because it's the 50s and you're a woman. Imagine that long before Facebook or eHarmony, you found a social organization of single Lutherans that results in countless marriages, but not necessarily for you. Imagine also that you go to visit your brother, the pastor, who now has four children, and find out that, as opposed to your ideal, you're finding that more of them are acting like Martin Luther's vision of little devils than the little angels that you expected. Does all of this stop you? No, it does not. You keep walking, walking, walking in the presence of God. You go, she worked to bring God's people together wherever there is a need. It's been already stated here many times, Luther League, these trips of going to Seattle, working with them for 10 years, the English immigrants, the kids programs, befriending our Liberian community, seeming unfazed by any sorrows or challenges that would arise, always wanting all of us to be at our best. Those of us children, that she was our aunt, we eventually became less little devils and got out into the real world. Even in later life, all of us here in the church through the office, things when people saw that walker coming, they knew there was a force to be reckoned with. I was with her many times in the grocery store, and that would be plowing right through. People would be getting ready. She wanted everyone to know that she loved everybody. She actually told me that she was actually happy she never found someone because it allowed her to be a part of so many lives. You know, how good that was. Miren que bueno indeed. Our Savior's God Elaine, now our Savior, gets her walking in his presence.
A reading from Proverbs. My child, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and abundant welfare they will give you. Do not let loyalty and faithfulness forsake you. Bind them round your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart, so you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and of people. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to
Elaine had a favorite Bible verse, too, several favorites, of course, and here's another one. God is the potter, and we are the clay, so we're hoping to sing together this round. We'll come out and lead you. Start singing the whole thing together.
We are the clay. We are the clay. You are the clay.
Please rise in body or spirit for the reading of the gospel. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to Jesus all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God the Potter and from Jesus Christ, our Savior, servant of all. Amen. Here at our Savior's, when we gather around the baptismal font here for a baptism, at the end of a baptism, we welcome the newly baptized and we all join together in a rousing rendition of This Little Light of Mine. And if the newly baptized one is a baby or a toddler, it is my joy as pastor to get to dance that little one all around the sanctuary as members of the congregation greet them with smiles and rejoicing. We all sing together, and I invite you to sing with me the last line. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Thanks be to God. Did Elaine let it shine? Amen. Some of us called her the Energizer Bunny sometimes in the last chapter of her life, as she seemed to miraculously rebound at hospitalization after hospitalization, health challenge after health challenge. She seemed unstoppable, and not only in body, but in spirit. She never ran out of wick, you could say, with that Christ candle that she bore. Over 7 decades, she let it shine here at Our Savior's, with the Altar Guild, setting tables for Holy Communion, preparing for baptisms, changing the paraments. She let it shine doing archives work and keeping records at her weekly shift in the office. She let it shine leading the youth group, convening single Lutheran adults. I could go on and on. You've heard already the many ways that she let it shine. And she certainly also let it shine among her family. And she lit up every time she talked about you. She was even letting it shine the last time that I visited her in the hospital when she could still converse. In my last visit with her, she was really not doing well physically. Her throat was very sore and very scratchy because she had a tube down her throat. And they were not letting her drink any water or even have ice chips in her mouth. But when I sat with her to talk and to listen, right away, she just started asking about others. How are Paul and Cam doing? How is church? She started expressing gratitude for Jeannie and Jean and all who had called her and visited her. The gratitude was just pouring out of her. She started sharing stories about the old days at church. She just went on and on. That week in worship before I visited her, the gospel text was from the Sermon on the Mount, and it was the part when Jesus is saying to the disciples, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." And I said to Elaine, "Elaine, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." And she just started laughing, and she said, "But it was so unconscious." Oh,
It was unconscious, yes, because Elaine was simply letting her light shine. She was living from that place of trusting in God. As we read in Proverbs this morning, verses that were written on Elaine's fridge, those Proverbs verses, truly loyalty and faithfulness to God were written on her heart. As I thought about Elaine's life of service to the church and to others, this story from Mark's gospel came to mind. This story comes right at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. He has just called his first four disciples and then done his first healing in a synagogue. Now he's going back to Simon's house with four of his disciples. And when they get there, he learns that Simon's mother-in-law is sick with a fever. And so Jesus goes to her, takes her by the hand, lifts her up, and she begins to serve them. Now, on the surface, this story can just seem to confirm patriarchal notions about what it means to be a woman in a man's world. Jesus heals her, and she starts serving the men. A woman's place is in the kitchen, the story seems to say. But if we look a little deeper, we see another story. The word translated here as serve is the Greek verb diakoneo, which can also be translated as to minister. It is the word that is at the root of the title deacon, a title that Elaine had in this church after she became an associate in ministry in 1985. And it's the word that Jesus used to describe his own mission and ministry and purpose later on in Mark's gospel, when he's with these four disciple guys later in Mark's story, and they're all arguing about who's the greatest and who deserves to sit next to Jesus in heaven. Jesus says to them, "Whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve." To serve. Friends, I know you didn't come here for a Greek lesson this morning, but I do want to point out one other connection in this text. The word used to describe the way that Jesus lifts this woman up is the same word that is used to describe when Jesus is raised up from the dead. And so it is that in this little story in Mark, this little sentence in Mark, we receive an image of what it looks like to follow in the way of Christ. When we are washed in the waters of baptism, we die to sin. We die to a life lived only for ourselves, for our own comfort, for our own profit. We die to a life constrained by the powers and principalities of this world, and we are lifted up to new life in Christ. We are lifted up from the fever of sin and death that afflicts us in this world, and we are invited to join Jesus in the great adventure of a life lived in service to others as the Spirit empowers us. We see in Elaine's life how Jesus lifted her, thanks be to God, from the poverty and grief that she experienced as a child after she lost her father at the age of 8. The church helped support her and her brother and mom through difficult times. Jesus lifted her. As a single woman in a patriarchal society, the sexist society, at a time when many women were valued according to how many children they had, as a single woman with only a high school education, she did not let the world define who she was. Jesus lifted her to be a servant leader in the church. And particularly at this church, right here at 24th in Chicago, with the whole city gathered around the door. And a quick story about that, when this church burned down and the whole city really did have its eye on our saviors, I heard a story from John about how when the TV reporter was outside filming about it, she went up and welcomed her with that beautiful smile and started inviting her to come to church. Ministering to the whole city outside the door. That was Elaine. And now at her death, we trust that Jesus has lifted Elaine one last time. Only this time not to serve, but to bask in the peace that passes understanding, in the love that knows no end, in the joy that is everlasting, with all the saints in light. Hours before her death, some of us here at Our Savior's went down to Abbott Northwestern, surrounded Elaine with our love and care. We prayed with her, we sang to her, we proclaimed God's promises to her. We anointed her body with oil, making the sign of the cross over various parts of her body. And as we anointed her feet, we said these words, "Receive the cross on your feet, that you may dance in the company of the saints forever." Friends in Christ, in her death, Jesus has taken our sister Elaine by the hand and has lifted her to dance in the freedom of eternal love and life and joy. Light perpetual shines on her. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Amen.
Thank you.
together, let us affirm our faith. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our authority and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us pray together. Loving God, give courage and faith to all who mourn. Sustain them by your care that flows by the Spirit through this community, extending far beyond what we can see, so they may have the strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, Creator God, we thank you for the good gifts of your earth that sustained Elaine in this life, and for the companionship and care of friends, family, congregation members, medical caregivers, and others who blessed her and who were blessed by her. For the gifts of human love and faithfulness, we give you thanks. God of mercy. Faithful God, grant to us who are still in our journey through this life the companionship of the Holy Spirit, that we might bear witness to your love and life, letting our lights shine, especially when this world groans in grief and pain. Lift each one of us up from the fever of sin and death to dance with you in the way of Jesus, the servant of all. Guide this congregation by your Spirit's wisdom, that our doors may be open to all who need healing and hope. God of mercy. Gracious Spirit, help us, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body to life everlasting. God of mercy. God of all grace, we give you thanks for your life-giving Spirit and for the life of our sister in Christ, Elaine. Make us certain that because Jesus lives, she lives, and we shall live also. Assure us that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of peace with one another. Peace be with you, Danny.
Peace be with you, Brother Ray. The Holy, Holy. There. Oh, yeah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them.
thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give us thanks and praise.
It is our duty and delight that we should everywhere and always offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, who by his death on the cross and glorious resurrection broke the bonds of sin and death and gave life to all creation. And so with the church on earth, all creation and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty and merciful God, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life and death, his resurrection and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O God, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Savior, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all glory and honor, now and forever. Amen. With the people of God throughout the ages and with the saints surrounding us, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Mother, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Everyone is invited to feast at God's table. The ushers will guide you when it is your turn to come forward. We'll have two communion lines. And on your way up, you'll grab a compostable cup. We have gluten-free wafers available for those who need them. Just ask your server. We have both bread, both wine and grape juice, and the grape juice is light-colored and has a gold ribbon around the handle. And if you'd rather not receive communion, you're still welcome to come forward and receive a blessing. So please ask your bread server for a blessing if that's what you prefer. And to those of you who are joining us online, hear these words addressed to you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Come to the feast of life. You may be seated.
Oh,
Now receive this blessing. The body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Mothering God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift, in faith towards you and in love towards one another. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Let us commend Elaine to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Elaine. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Before the blessing, I want to share a couple of announcements with you. First, you're invited to join the family for a reception after the service. We'll share in a lunch together. And second, it was requested by Elaine and the family that memorial donations be made to our Savior's Lutheran Church Foundation in her honor. So if you would like to do that, it's a foundation that sustains the mission and ministry of this congregation, you can place an offering in the basket. That also is the card basket out there. I invite you to rise in body or spirit for the blessing. God bless you and keep you. God's face shine on you with grace and mercy. God look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
Land of the living in the land. sisters and my brothers around me, sisters and brothers around me. I shall sing all the sisters and the brothers around me, sisters and brothers around me. I shall sing, oh, with my sisters and brothers around me, I shall sing.
And we go on our way rejoicing, celebrating a beautiful life.